Hi, this is Warren Vlass, and in a couple minutes, me and Cody Brockway will be interviewing guitar legend Steve Hackett for the Peter Gabriel fans page. We will cover the current tour that he's on, his two albums that he put out earlier this year, Surrender of Silence and Under a Mediterranean Sky, and some other questions regarding the album Seconds Out and his career. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the interview. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Hey, Steve. How you doing?
Very good. Thank you, Warren. How are you?
Good. We're doing this for the Peter Gabriel fans page. I want to introduce my co-host, Cody Brockway, who will be asking him questions along with me, and the legendary Steve Hackett, who we know from Genesis days in his solo career. And just an overall really great guy. So, Steve, how's the tour going? How what's the UK leg of the tour?
Well, we just did 31 dates throughout the UK. We managed to complete all of the dates. It's the longest tour I've ever done of the UK, and we also. We were doing Seconds Out. We did Seconds Out in its entirety, the Genesis album from 77, and some solo stuff as well. In about a week and a half, we head off to Scandinavia, and we do Finland, Denmark, Norway. We have Paris. I'm trying to remember where else we get to go. I'm out of touring next year. Canada.
Yeah, and you're coming to Boston too, I see.
So. Yes.
And the Oakville Center, which I'll see you there.
Yes, I'll be doing that as well. Yeah, looking forward to it. It's been great because we've had 2 years off, really. 2 years off of gigging, but lots of recording.
Because the last time I saw you was in Western Massachusetts, and that was, I think you did one or two more shows after that, and then you had to cancel. Everything.
The whole tour was canceled because everywhere closed down around us.
Yeah, COVID and this and that.
So as a drummer, I really admire you. I'm a big fan. I've met you probably five times with my dad at the Oakville Center. And I just got to ask what it's like working with a drummer like Craig Blundell.
Well, it's been very interesting.
Because Frost is amazing.
The band. Sorry, what did you say?
But he was in a band called Frost for a while, right?
Right, okay.
And Frost are amazing.
Right. Well, he is an amazing drummer. He hits those drums very, very hard. And he's on stage, just the acoustic sound of the drums. I don't need to have any of it in my monitor. I hear him loud and clear on any stage, no matter how big it is. And I have to rely on the sound guy out front getting my guitar up to the same level electrically. And I'm fairly loud compared to him on the drums, just acoustically. So he puts a lot of energy into his performance. I think he's like a kind of somewhere between heavy metal and a mathematician. He seems to be able to subdivide at will and come up with variations, which are extraordinary. He's a very, very clever player. I just get more and more impressed the more I've been working with him.
Well, that fits with your music, with the music you play, because like all the Genesis stuff and your solo stuff is not, like it takes a good musician to play it on any front.
Yeah, I think people can level criticism at progressive stuff by saying it's too complicated, the music. But I think that any music that's played well with any kind of commitment, whether it's a simple form like blues, it still takes a great player to bring it alive. So it's not about the form, it's the spirit. And I can listen to any music if I hear a great player doing it. That's really it. It's the spirit that comes through. Yeah, the form changes. But the beauty of someone who's on top of it and informing it and playing as if it was their life depended on it is what I kind of rely on. And then it's really, truly, truly alive. Doesn't matter whether it's British prog or Delta blues or classical music. It's all about, it comes alive in the hands of the player or indeed the singer.
I agree with you. I go from jazz guys like McCoy Tyner to you to Slipknot to AC/DC and Yes. Like, I just love, like what you said, as long as there's an emotion to it, as long as there's feeling to it, then that's what, like blues with a feeling, right?
That's right. I many years ago, I did a blues album called Blues with a Feeling, and I always think when I look back on it, I think, I can do things now that I couldn't do then. So maybe my approach will be slightly different, but all music grows. And it's not a case of better or worse. It's a case of just different. It would be different now because you become a different person, a different player, but you'll still be engaged by the same things that you heard from others.
Exactly. And as you grow as a musician, you sort of start to develop different tastes for different things. I totally get it. 100%.
Well, that's right. I think, when I was very young, starting out, once I got hooked on guitars, I tended to hear guitars to the exclusion of all the other things. And then I had to learn to listen to the other instruments and appreciate them for what they could bring to the plot. So, I had a vague idea of something when I thought I heard a good drummer on something. But I couldn't tell you why at that stage. And still, the art of what a drummer does, to a large degree, is a mystery to me. How does it work? The alchemy between all those things that they're conjuring within one kit, whether it's a straightforward beat or there's all these embellishments. There's so many different ways of playing every rhythm.
Absolutely, I agree.
And now you have, like, you seem to have a really magic thing going on with Roger King.
Yes.
He really seems to bring the theatrical, into the music and this and that, where almost the music sounds like it's like it could be in a movie often.
He has had a background in movies. Roger was trained as a cathedral organist, and he obviously is a brilliant engineer and all-rounder. But he, over and above that, he was working on some famous movies. He was doing music for In the Name of the Father and Cliffhanger, that you guys might be familiar with, Sylvester Stallone movie. Usually someone else was getting the credit for the music, but he said that very often it's left to the backroom boys, as he was at the time. So I know that he has a great orchestral sense. So if ever we want to do anything that has a filmic, cinematic feel to it, I know that he's got a very good grasp of what orchestral instruments can do. So Sometimes we use reels, sometimes we use samples, sometimes we mix the two. But it's been great working with him. He's really the musical director of the band that I have. So if there's close attention to detail, it usually means that he's been there and been part of it.
Jonas Reingold, can you talk about him? He seems to be, how long has he been with you?
It's been a few years now. He's a fantastic player. He seems to be able to play in any style. He also plays upright double bass. He's played with orchestras. He's played with prog people. He also likes metal stuff. Very interesting. And he's the fastest bass player I've ever heard. When you hear him on his own, when he's just warming up, it's just phenomenally good. So left to their own devices on stage, if I'm a little late to the sound check, what tends to happen is they go into a jazz odyssey.
That must be awesome.
They'll be playing things that will be pieces that I won't necessarily know, but Rob is a jazz professor. He teaches music, and Craig, as you know, and Jonas, they're all incredible lead instrumentalists, leaders in their field, and it's great to be able to work with a crack regiment like that. They're world class, so I know that the music is fully alive when I'm cool.
Someone that you worked with in the past, Thomas Dolby, is also a professor here in the States. I'm trying to think of the university down in Baltimore, but I saw him a couple of years ago, and he basically ran the concert like you were in class, like you were in like a college class and all stuff like that. It was very unique and very fun.
My connection is nearly that I met him once, and I told him that I had a copy of the soundtrack to the film Gothic, which I believe he did, and with Gabriel Byrne, loosely based on the life of Lord Byron. And right at the end, there's a track which I think Timothy Spall might have done, but it was a very theatrical kind of voiceover based thing, a kind of almost like a Shakespearean rap or an actor's rap, and the track was called The Devil Is an Englishman. And I first heard that at a show which was run by a friend of mine. It was a thing called the Alternative Hair Show, and at that time it was a charity event in London, and I remember being very impressed with the track and what they did with it live. So I did a version of it on, I think it's on the album To Watch the Storms. So I did a version of The Devil Is an Englishman, so I could, be a kind of thespian, theatrical thing. I did it for fun. It's one of those jokey tracks. So that was my connection with him. Other than that, I know that he'd worked with Joni Mitchell. Other than that, I don't know too much.
That leads me to a question then.
Yeah.
Because I know a couple of years ago that you did some work with Chris Squire from Yes. And I know that even long before that, you did some work with Brian May from Queen.
Yeah.
What was it like? What was the creative process like working with those two guys?
Interesting working with Brian. Brian May... We first met in Brazil, and Queen were there for a festival called Rock in Rio, which at that time used to happen about once every 2 years.
Yeah.
And I met Brian. He said, "Oh, Steve," I was influenced by what you did with Genesis with the track Musical Box. He said, I like that. And right at the end of Musical Box, there was a three-part harmony guitar solo.
Oh, yeah.
As soon as anyone does a three-part harmony guitar solo, they sound like Brian May, I always think, but he says there's a nod to me. So there are a number of guitar solos on that piece. I get to play three different solos on that song. And Brian is an incredible player, an incredible writer, a unique sound, a very quick thinker. And he worked unbelievably quickly, seemed to come up with ideas at will, you know, just like picking them off, berries off a tree. We tried this idea, this idea, this idea. And they're very energetic, very nice guy, very self-effacing, but knows what he wants.
Yeah.
And at the time when I met him, of course, Freddie was still alive. We worked on an album which only came out years and years later, which was called Feedback 86. We did that. We also did a charity project together called Rock Against Repatriation. It was when the Hong Kong boat people were being repatriated back to mainland China, Vietnam, and all that kind of stuff. So that was it's very interesting that he was helping me with that, along with a whole bunch of other dignitaries in rock in the British scene. Very nice working with him. Funnily enough, I've got hold of a copy of one of the guitars that he invented.
No way.
He sell those. Yeah, that's interesting. So a friend of mine has lent me this guitar, which is invented by Brian, and it's one of the great sounding guitars that I have in my possession at the moment. I'm hoping this guy's going to let me buy the guitar off him. Otherwise, I'll have to buy one off Brian. It's a great sounding guitar. Got a great facility to put the pickups out of phase. And it's amazing to think that he designed that guitar with his father.
Yeah.
When he was very young, I think when he was 15, 16. It's a picture of him looking very young when he's about 16, playing this guitar.
Wow.
Rock and roll hairdo.
You and Brian are two of my favorite guitar players. Like, I love Genesis and Queen to the maximum extent. And just, yes, very, very awesome. Thank you for answering that question.
Thank you for that. He's a great player. I remember hearing demos that Queen had that Charisma Records were listening to. And it was very, very early on. It might have been 1971. And I thought, wow, who is this guitarist at the time? Because it was heavily dragged up stuff. And I thought, well, wow, if this is the demos, you know, what's the record going to sound like? Unfortunately, they didn't sign to Charisma. Nonetheless, of course, they blazed a huge trail. And an incredible band. Course, you know, one of those unstoppable British forces.
Well, you guys like Genesis also helped create a huge following with the prog rock world too. Like, you know, there's a lot of bands that came after you guys that were heavily influenced by stuff like Selling England by the Pound and The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway. So how does that feel to know, like, when another famous musician comes up and says, well, I was influenced by your work, you know, you're playing on Seconds Out. Eddie Van Halen often credits you for, you know, influencing his tapping and like technique and all that sort of thing. How does that feel for you?
Well, it's humbling because I always think that I'm trying to improve on what I did yesterday all the time. And whatever you do, there is always inspiration to be gained from others. So for me, I'm influenced by so many people, and none of us really stand alone. I think that's the thing. So any hero worship has to be spread, you know, across this land of giants, that we stand on the shoulders of giants, or is it that we add a footnote to the great work that others have done, and many of my heroes are no longer with us. Nonetheless, I'm still impressed. I get impressed by playing. I get impressed by someone's tone. How did they figure out, configure the amp in that way? How did they do this? And how did they do that? And magic always seems to be something that someone else does. With my own constructions, if it's a machine, I can see the nuts and the bolts and know where it's come from. But I can listen to someone else's work and think that's unassailably good. And I don't know what the route is that they took to get there. And I don't know if they were trying to sound like someone else along the way, but it never seems like the gospel. It always seems like for personal work, you always think, well, it's nice if people want to follow what I do, but my sights are always set somewhere else.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. I mean, it's just that whole, like, if someone comes up to you and says, oh man, I love what you did on this song, that would for sure feel.
Oh, well, yeah, of course. It's very nice that people think like that. And yeah. I've been accused of being too humble. I don't feel comfortable with saying, yeah, I invented this and I came up with that. And,
oh, of course, of course.
Yeah, you know what I mean? I think that I have met people who are very, very, very self-assured. And that must be nice, to feel that you're the greatest all the time.
Oh, no. To be too egocentric is not, that's not but what a real, like a real musician is more open.
Even guys like Hendrix were very self-effacing.
Yeah.
But then you get someone like Andres Segovia playing acoustic guitar who would be fairly full of himself, but in a very colourful way. And he would say something like about guitar playing. He would say, if there weren't so many sinners, there wouldn't be any need for a pope. So, yeah, it's a way of conferring something upon
him. So you don't need to brag about it. You don't need to do this. I think it's just a lot of confidence and a lot of professionalism on your part.
So I think somebody said years ago, and it was a very good quote, the only difference between an amateur and a professional is that a professional keeps trying.
True.
And there's nothing worse than someone who's an amateur who wants to tell you that he's the greatest, because I don't buy into that. As soon as I see someone say, oh, I'm the greatest, that's when if you have to tell somebody you're great, if they can't feel how great you are by listening to what you do, but you have to tell them that you're great, chances are you're not.
Yeah, it's strange. I mean, there are some really great players who say this, and you think, yeah, well, the music speaks for itself, but yeah. I'd rather not be told that someone's the greatest. I'd really rather like to get there of my own volition and say, yeah, this guy is absolutely wonderful, and that'll do. But I'm not sure that anyone's the greatest, because it's not a competition. It's not a knocking.
I love that humble attitude that you keep. I think it's very inspirational, and I think more people should be like that. So that's good.
Well, there are so many great people out there. I think that's the truth. And many of them are humble and many of them are not. They come in all shapes and sizes.
Now, talking about being humble and all stuff like that, I think this is a great time to talk about the era of Seconds Out, which basically covers your time in the band.
Seconds Out is a compilation album. It's a live album. It's a double. And it features music from 1971 to 77, which covers the entire period that I was with the band. So many of those songs I've re-recorded and played live hundreds of times. And of course, when we do it live, there's different technology that I'm using. I mean, I've got a guitar that will sustain till the cows come home. And so it means I can play very slowly with that. I don't have to end my phrases in the way that I used to have to. There's so many sounds that you can make with the guitar, like the Fernandez. It can sound like a police car siren. It can sound like a trumpet. It can sound like the human voice. It can scream. It can do all sorts of things. So there'll be me wishing that I'd had that technology when I recorded those originals. But nonetheless, as a live album, don't forget it's cherry picking over some of the best that we did during those 6 or 7 years. And it's been lovely to revisit it. I have no problem with doing that and playing it live. I'm very proud of the way the band reinterprets that in a way where I think I have to, you know, hold back, and I'm comparing it with how Genesis sounded at the time. And when you've got a bunch of virtuosos like we have on stage, I know that it's not going to fall below a certain level live. So it justifies it completely. Of course, that's not all I do live. I do solo stuff as well. So you've got to have if you've got a foot in the past doing the stuff and keeping the museum doors open, as I've often said, with these glorious old exhibits, I think what keeps it fresh for me is including some new stuff with the same band, recorded with, you know, largely with the same band. So we'll do something like the Devil's Cathedral, for instance, where Roger gets to do his cathedral organ bit and Rob gets to play octatonics on the sax, and it'll be different every night. And nobody knows exactly what they're going to do, but by the end of a certain cue, drums are in and the song takes off. So I employ the same philosophy when I do Genesis stuff. That, say, for instance, we do Los Endos. I don't do exactly the same arrangement that we did with the original. And of course, we're not using two drummers. We're using one. And the thing about Craig is, in many ways, he's like listening to two drummers at once anyway. So he's doing a phenomenal amount of things. The octopus effect is complete with him. And we'll change the arrangement to include some other things as well. But the main thing is for a high energy number like Los Endos to keep it coming. So it'll go in and out of ideas that I had and that I've imposed upon it, to go in and out of slogans from Defector and then back again into the iconic bits, what I consider to be the iconic bits. So, you know, my version of this Genesis stuff is what I think is the best of Genesis. To do it without agenda. It doesn't matter who wrote the song. It's that you do something that sounds great. That's the brief. Many of these things were written by Peter Gabriel, and Pete was absolutely great with the band. He was a tremendous thinker and singer and writer and hustler and all of that. He was extraordinary. So. And a lovely guy as well. So Genesis owes him a huge debt that's never going to go away. Now, Nad, many years ago, he did an album. And he had a musical partner. And at that time, he wrote on it, it's the kind of songs that Genesis could have done or would have done if it had been a different lineup. And so I think that it was always his dream to be the Genesis lead singer. So I heard something that he'd done. He recorded a version of the Chamber of 32 Doors with Nick Virgilio from The Lamb. And Roger and I auditioned him. He came over from Sweden and we ran through a few things, Watch of the Sky, etc. And he just had such an extraordinary physical presence and this great voice. So over time, I found that he does Peter Gabriel very well and plausibly. He does Phil Collins very well. he considers himself a bit of a chameleon, and some nights we were doing some stuff I recorded with Richie Havens, and did a great version of Icarus Ascending from Please Don't Touch. So he seems to have this ability to be able to deepen his voice and place it, and he's got a huge range. So he seems like the, I might upset people by saying this, but I'll say it anyway, the logical successor to those guys with that material. I mean, he lives it, and when he sings it, he really seems to own it. Now, I have worked with other people too who've done, you know, great versions of these things, great singers. John Wetton, the late great John Wetton, and Ray Wilson, I think, did a great job with Genesis. And, you know, we recorded, you know, both live and in the studio, a version of Carpet Crawlers. And again, you know, a great take on what's become known as a classic song. So as I said before, there's room for everybody. And I've been lucky to work with great people like Nad, who really, he really lives the song when he sings it and presents it in a certain way that I think is very flamboyant and is probably closer to the Peter Gabriel school of approach than Phil, who tends to sort of interpret it in a much more workmanlike way, where he's being the singer, he's being the drummer, and hardly likely to dress up in bat wings and all the rest, but Phil's sense of theatricality is something that's quite natural to him with his theatrical training. But I think that for Nad, his whole being is theatrical and flamboyant, and his natural home is the stage. There's no doubt about it. But he's, I think he's at his happiest when he's on stage.
Which leads me to a question. The guitar work on that, I personally think, is incredible on the whole album. I really like it. But there's one question that I have about a solo that you play on the song Counting Out Time.
Yeah.
What effect do you use on the guitar? Because it doesn't sound like a guitar, but I know it's a guitar. What is the effect that you use there?
The device was a synthy hi-fi. It was a couple of pedals, and it actually had quite a limited palette of sounds. It was less a synthesizer, more of an extended pedal, really. But it had some very interesting sounds. So I had this extreme vibrato on it, which went above and below the note, made just about every note you played absolutely yodel through. So it was meant to be slightly comical. So I had this comical sound, and I was trying to play like Django Reinhardt with comical sound. So,
well, I think you did good with that, because I think that's probably, from a lyrical standpoint, one of the funniest songs that Peter ever wrote. And to have like your solo really, really backs up the whole comic value.
Yeah, it was really, a really, really silly sound. I don't think I ever managed to get it to sound quite like that live when I used the synthy hi-fi. But it's funny that gets a mention from time to time, that solo. Yeah.
It was a moment in time, my friend. It was a moment in time.
Yeah, it's a moment there, and it's a passing thought, and I did something that was fairly throwaway, but I'm glad it stuck with.
It caught on.
I wasn't trying to be reverential.
Oh, yes.
Now, going to your current albums that you just came out with this past year, Under a Mediterranean Sky and Surrender of Silence. The two are very different. One's an acoustical album, and the other one is a heavier rock album. We're going to play two songs right now. from it. So one from each. So like Barbara, Adriatic Blue. Contrast between the two albums are like done on purpose, where one seems like heaven and the other one seems like hell.
I think sometimes with acoustic stuff that it's a little bit of a glimpse at heaven. I try and do stuff that's romantic and in the main gentle, and there's a huge classical influence with the way that I play nylon guitar. I think I was hugely influenced by an album I first heard in 1965 when I was 15 years old, and it was Segovia Plays Bach. And the Bach stuff, when I first heard it, I thought, oh, how is it possible for anyone to play music that complex on a guitar? It seemed absolutely miraculous, and it was an absolute gold standard for me. So I fell in love with that kind of playing, and then over time I started to learn to use the fingernails, and this is over decades, of course. And so I have done a few albums of that kind of instrumental stuff, sometimes with an orchestra, very often on its own, vanilla guitar. But, you know, Segovia said that the guitar was like a small orchestra, really. And it was very inspirational. So, yes, that can be very heavenly. Rock stuff, I find, and you're quite right about Surrender of Silence, is a very hellish sounding album at times. It is very aggressive. It still has a classical influence from time to time, but it's the closest thing I've done to heavy metal. And I do like the basic simplicity of that. But like I was saying about blues earlier, it's a case of who's playing it and what you do with it. So, some things can be a bit of an excuse to have a rave up on the guitar, but I was also lyrically on Surrender of Silence. There are a lot of things that are social comment and talking about the inequalities in the world between the haves and the have-nots, and the way media can manipulate and the way news can be reported with a certain bias. So I was sounding off about that. So there are also aspects of ecological concerns and climate change. So all of that gets addressed. So I suspect the lyrics are less romantic and escapist, and they're more direct, and they're talking in a way that, that protest songs do. But if there's an if there's a genre of protest prog, it's probably this.
I wanted to ask about Surrender of Silence. I noticed that there's a huge heavy metal influence on it. And yeah, with more of your recent releases, there's a very cinematic feel. It, like, almost like the music feels like you're in a movie or something. Do you know what I mean? Like, how do you, how does that come across? How do you go about getting that sound?
Well, very often I think when you're watching a movie, and a movie from any era, classical people won't always get the chance to sit down and write a concerto or a symphony, because orchestras have to be funded, and so there has to be an accompanying project with it. But it seems to me that people who would have perhaps come up with those concertos and symphonies are the people working in film. And you you hear the great work of Max Steiner with Gone with the Wind, for instance, or Miklós Rozsa doing so many of those epics that were around in the 1950s, the Ben-Hur stuff with Charlton Heston. Wonderful film score, so much beautiful music. So I think that modern cinema carries so much of the weight and the experience of classical music. So I get influenced by that. So I'm influenced by the modern stuff. I love screaming guitars, but I also love the gentle sighing sounds of the guitar sounding a lot like a harp or like keyboard. Guitars are very adaptable things. So I think you can do both.
Now, did Peter Gabriel have an influence on this, where he does kind of the same thing in his music, where he can, you know, lyrically take a song and make you kind of see a movie like Intruder, songs like that. So
Well, I think that that album, Peter Gabriel number 3, Intruder, is a very interesting track, very interesting perspective, where drums become central, the pivot point, and the production on No Self-Control is still, or the arrangement rather, is still very much driven by percussion. And up to then, I think that he'd been operating more in a romantic or traditional tradition. Whereas at that point, I think that he'd invented his own style. I remember talking to him about this at the time when we were doing some live work together. We did a couple of projects. We did, I turned up on the Milton Keynes Reformation with him, and he'd helped me with a charity project that I was doing for a children's hospital that we were trying to keep open, successfully as it happens. And I think he shared a love of orchestras and reinterpreting songs so that an orchestra could do it. And I think his latterly, he seemed to slow down songs, and they were still being used for movies. So, and he also said to me when I was playing nylon guitar one day, at the time of Lambas Down on Broadway, he said, "Whenever you play something like that, it makes me think of beautiful ladies." So I guess it would make him, it would spark a kind of romantic thing, because there is an aspect of chamber music that you hear with nylon guitar if it's played gently. Baroque music, influenced by that, influenced by flamenco, influenced by so many different things.
Now, have you talked to Peter over the COVID lockdowns and this and that? Have you talked to him since then?
We sent each other some emails. He sent me some very funny stuff, because we practically share the same birthday. We're just a day apart, so we always wish each other happy birthday. And he said he he said, this is a couple of years back, he said, I had a shock today. I looked in the mirror and I saw a 70-year-old man staring back at me. And that was typical of his humor. It's always lovely to hear from him. And I will always adore Pete. You know, without Pete, I think it might have taken me a lot longer to get into the industry, but he took a chance on me. And if that doesn't sound too much like an ABBA song back in the day.
Have you guys thought about, not a Genesis thing, but have you and Peter ever, you know, conversed about teaming up for a new project, like a solo album, maybe this like a one-off record like you did with Chris or that sort of thing? Have you thought about that with Peter?
Well, I think that Pete often takes 10 years to make a record and I take 10 minutes. Somewhere between the two, you've got these contradictory philosophies. I'm joking. Nothing takes 10 minutes. But I think that I'm completely open to that. But I'm also aware of being deferential and not wanting to hit him up for favors. And I think he's done me quite enough favors in the past. So if he ever wants me to do anything with him, I'd be, very, very happy to do so, because I love him to bits.
So that leads me to another question, is the fact that you have been very prolific, especially, well, throughout your whole career, but I'm thinking in the last 5 or 6 years, you've put out a lot of albums.
Yeah.
And I know that you draw influences from many places, like you travel a lot and that sort of thing. What is the protocol when you sit down to write a song? What is your creative process like? Maybe just show us a bit of that.
Well, if I'm writing something instrumental, and indeed, if it's something instrumental that gets used in a vocal tune at some point, it all starts with a doodle. First of all, it's the snippet of this and a snippet of that. And it doesn't all get written chronologically.
Right.
I wish the day that I pick up the guitar to work on something, that would be it. Yeah, write the song. You know, why don't we have the party right here, guys? Yeah, boom, boom. And But it tends not to work like that. You mentioned, you know, the travelogue aspect of visiting places and getting influenced by the music from there, and then trying to paint the picture back in music of what it's like to visit these places. Very often it will be my wife, Jo, will say, perhaps we could do something in an African style, or indeed with the acoustic album Under a Mediterranean Sky. It was she who suggested the whole concept of the album, which was to do acoustic music which typified or described many regions around the Mediterranean Sea.
Said, I knew that Joe had an influence on you on that.
She did. You're quite right. And she said it would be much broader than doing something that was just in a Baroque tradition or flamenco. It would widen it to further afield. And I was having a conversation with an interviewer earlier today. He was saying, "Oh, have you thought about doing this sort of stuff, certain songs live?" And may have been mentioning it yourself. And so, some things are easy to do. Some things I have done live from that album. It's one way of working, and that also permeates through the rock stuff as well. So, from Shanghai to Samarkand is a tune that was trying to describe from the East, from the Middle East, a whole region or several regions all at once. And again, another song that I'm very fond of on the album, the Russian-inspired Natalia. The idea was Joe's, first of all. And sometimes she will sing me melodies, and then I go, well, let's see if we can do that. So, The Memory of Myth, for instance, is her melody. And so it's played on unaccompanied violin, a cappella violin at the beginning. And then there's a string arrangement of it after I've done my improvisational stuff. And Roger did a wonderful string arrangement there on a tune of hers. So, you know, it's a lot about other writers and obviously what Roger brings to it as well. So,
so how often...
I don't stand alone.
Yeah, so how many hours a day do you have a guitar in your hand?
I'm not usually so great at coming up with ideas at midnight when I've got a guitar in my hand. I'll get tired, but I might get the idea for a top line or a harmony and I'll write it down on paper. So it's usually earlier in the day that I've got a guitar in my hand.
Okay. So Cody owns a record store in Canada. Right. And I know you're big on vinyl.
Vinyl has been the saving grace of many a record store, whereas CDs tended to have been sidelined. But I believe in all formats, to be honest. If I love something, I usually want to own it in some format or other. The beauty of vinyl, I would say for rock, is that you get extra compression and distortion, so it gives it a sound. It can sometimes warm it up. At the same time, if you're doing something and you want pristine moments of silence as you're doing it, I think your best bet is to have CD. That's just my own take on it. So it depends what you're listening to. Horses for courses. But yeah, hooray for record stores. Believe me, when our local record store closed down in Richmond, in London, it was a sad day for me to think, you know, everything has gone, you know, from all those heroes, suddenly it's turned into a used clothing store or something like that. And you think, oh, wow, I didn't think that was going to happen in my lifetime. But romantics like me, and I suspect like yourself, we have to fight to keep music alive.
Yes.
In whatever way we do it, whether it's playing live, selling live, visiting record stores, encouraging. I'm not so keen on Spotify and the whole idea. I've heard that album once, and so I know what that's all about. I mean, personally, if I hear something great, I want to own it. I don't like the idea of it being remote. So somehow it's like investing in it. I want to be an investor.
Yeah. Hey, Alexa, and plus you have the artwork and you have the inner sleeves and you have all the other things that you can do with vinyl and all stuff like that. Like, yeah. I remember like when I was a kid, I would go out and get 3, 4, 5 albums, come home, I would spend my whole afternoon listening, looking at the albums, looking at the artwork, looking at the inner sleeves, all these things that you know you don't get with a download.
Well, it sounds like music changed your life, as indeed it did mine. And many times my life has been enriched and changed so much for the better with the gift of music.
Yeah. And here we are. I'm talking to the great Steve Hackett right now.
Yeah, so. mine too, Steve. I'm only 23 years old, just turned, and my parents have had me, you know, I'm a drummer. I've been hooked on music ever since I was born, and vinyl is where it's at for me. I opened up my own store when I was about 17 years old in my hometown, Caledonia, Ontario, which is only 30 minutes from the Oakville Performing Arts.
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah.
I'll have you know that your albums always sell particularly very well at my store. Your solo album.
Thank you very much. It sounds like you're doing a great job there. I mean, I think everyone who's talking here is doing their bit to promote music, their favorite music. And the subtext of music, I think, is to not only re-energize people and give them joy, but sometimes literally to heal. And when you live a song, when it changes your life, as indeed it will do for people who are professional musicians, But more than that, I know that many people are great, great listeners, and it's as much about that as it is the people who make it, because the people who make it will often be very critical of themselves and each other, whereas the listener, it's all the more joyful for not knowing anything about the process.
Exactly.
I wanted to show you this quickly, Steve. This is my business card from my store.
Okay.
20 Argyle Street, North Caledonia. I mean, this is a long shot, but I know you're going to be in Oakville in March, which I will be at your shows that you're doing there. Can't wait for that. But yeah, I mean, if you're into buying vinyl, which I know you are, I'm open.
Right. Well, if I can possibly come by, and if there's time, I will.
So I don't know how you have time for anything. I know you're such
a busy... I don't know how I have time for anything. You know, sometimes I'm too busy to call my mother.
And, I know you are always kept very busy, and you're very prolific with what you do. And thank you for
your... In fact, I have to go do another interview now in 15 minutes. Yeah. So
okay. So yeah, we're gonna close it up with one final thing.
Okay.
And the Norwegian part of the tour is coming up. So, Barbara?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Well, I'm looking forward to going back to some of those places that I've done before. But at this time, it's been a while since I've done Finland. So I'm looking forward to that. First time I did Finland was, I was playing Turku Festival there with Hanoi Rocks, who were, I think, a local band, and also Whitesnake, and I was talking to them for the first time. Very interesting. Yeah, that was wild. Finland is wild. I'm looking forward to going back. It's a buzz. It really is. I mean, playing live is a huge privilege anyway, and it's a blast when I'm able to play with a band like the one that I've got at the moment. You just know that it's an all-out assault in a good way. Nobody dies.
And you got the Monte Carlo Jazz Festival.
That's right, yeah.
You know, in Monaco. So,
yes.
Are you playing a different set there? Are you going to be playing jazz rather than
no.
Your normal set?
We'll be playing... the solo set and also the seconds out set. So I think you would be hard pushed to say that it was jazz, although of course Rob Townsend does bring a jazz element to it, and in a way so much of that stuff that in some ways predated fusion, I like to think, or the term collision. Genesis embodied that within its portals.
Okay, but I want to thank everyone, Steve, especially you, for taking the time out of your busy schedule.
Thank you.
And I know that you are, you know, I know that you're a very busy man and all stuff like that. And I am amazed at your stamina. I don't know how you do it.
I don't know either. You know, if I listen to my body too closely, the nice thing is when you're playing live, the idea is you feel no pain. Music takes away pain. It is the healer. Yeah.
Maybe it's like, okay, like the saying goes, like if you enjoy what you do, you never work a day in your life.
Yeah, that's it. That's a good thing. If you love what you do, that's how it works. And I'm lucky to do what I love for a living.
Okay, so thank you
Steve, like, for, you know, all the years of music and for all the concerts and stuff. I always tell people that there's nothing like seeing the Steve Hackett show. If you're a fan of Genesis, to always go see your show. I've turned on a number of people to your live concerts, and I plan on doing more in the future, and I hope we can do this again soon. Thank you for talking to Warren.
Thank you. Been lovely talking to you all, and best of luck to you all and all of your audience there. So,
okay.
Great talking.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you again, Steve.
Thank you.
Okay. Man.
All the best.
All right. Bye-bye.
Okay. Take care.
And there you have it, my friends, the interview with Steve Hackett for the Peter Gabriel's fans page. I hope that you enjoyed. Me and Cody hope to bring you more interviews in the future with famous musicians. So we're going to leave you with this. Steve Hackett playing the classic Genesis song, Supper's Ready. Enjoy. Rock on, everybody.